Ambulance services to patient breathing.
Nos.
I'm going to give you further instruction of how to give basic life support. Is he fitting now?
Yeah.
She's unresponsive. Can't hear her breathing.
Oh, stand by.
This is a 12-hour shift with West Midlands Ambulance Service.
This job is definitely not for the faint-hearted.
How quick do you reckon the car was going?
Oh, good job of that, Bab.
Every 20 seconds, they receive a call for help.
She was having some kind of seizure.
We can't hear her breathing.
From the 5.6 million people who live here.
What's your name, my lovely?
Realistically, this could be anything that you're walking into.
Unconscious, blood coming from ears.
Any chance of an overdose?
The chances of you dying are incredibly high.
Filming simultaneously with 8 paramedic crews.
That's not a good sign.
Open your eyes for me, mate. Open your eyes for me.
This is life on the front line.
If an ambulance doesn't get there, the bottom line is people could die.
How did you sleep?
Not very well.
So
I won't lie.
I didn't sleep long enough.
It's the beginning of another 12-hour night shift. As it's a Friday evening, it promises to be a busy one for the paramedics.
Do you prefer a night in or a night out?
Well, are we talking going out out? Because there is a difference between night out and going out out.
Night in. I definitely choose a night in.
I love a night in. Film, heating on, hot chocolate.
Probably with a blanket.
Big Arsenal with dogs.
What, like ballroom or...?
Yeah, exactly that.
I've got one of those blankets which looks like a tortilla wrap. So basically, you're a burrito, you wrap yourself up.
I can't think of anything worse than doing what the kids today do.
I think it's one of those things in this job, when you see the carnage that happens on a Friday and Saturday night, like whatever we're going to see tonight, it sort of puts you off from going out, out.
How are we? Managed to get a good sleep?
Yeah, I had a couple hour nap after I went to the gym this morning.
Oh, gym before a night shift.
It's my routine.
Not a chance.
I was so annoyed today. I got home and next to our washing machine, we've got like a little shelf where we keep like alcohol. So basically, where the washing machine was on spin and it goes mad vibrations, it knocked a bottle of my favourite rum off the shelf and smashed all over the floor.
I think Brad knows a little bit more about me than he probably cares to wish for.
How much alcohol have you got in your house? We've got shelves and shelves and shelves.
No, not that much.
We have.
I think spending 12 hours with somebody in an ambulance can definitely cause a little bit of oversharing. You certainly get very close very quickly.
The more alcohol you have in your house, actually, the less you probably are a drinker. But I have alcohol just because I like the bottles of it.
You find yourself opening up to your crewmate, so I think your crewmate knows a hell of a lot about you.
But like when you go abroad or something, they've got like really nice bottles in there.
You pay attention to very odd things, don't you, as you can tell it?
Yeah.
Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
She's unresponsive.
Is her chest falling and rising with at least one breath every 10 seconds?
No, can't hear her breathing.
So I'm going to give you advice on how to give life support, OK?
New job. Cardiac arrest. So we've been diverted. We're now going to a category one.
Hearing a cardiac arrest come through automatically gets your heart going. It automatically gets you thinking.
What's coming through is a female cardiac arrest.
In a cardiac arrest, every second counts. The outcome of a good survival with every second is decreasing.
Apparently there is someone with her that says patient is not breathing. And that's it, really.
I think every job we attend, we never know what we're going to walk into. particularly at night, I'm always a little bit more fearful of that.
Who is this? Who have we got here?
This is my niece. Yeah. We've been out today. It's been our dad's funeral today.
Yeah.
She's been sick.
You can obviously see her lying on the floor, and there's quite a big group of people. That to me is quite an early warning sign of this patient's probably really unwell.
Any chance of an overdose? Can you hear me, sweetheart? Who have I got here, sorry?
This is her
dad. Dad.
An ambulance was called when the patient was found collapsed in the street outside her family home.
Any drug use at all? Any possibility of an overdose? Fine. I need some space, please. I want Dad here and that's it, really.
I think having a crowd surrounding you when you're trying to assess and treat a patient can be quite challenging at times. Quite often you'll have two or three or even four or five people trying to tell you the story.
5.3 and 36.4. Hello, sweetheart. It's OK. Just the ambulance,
you talk
darling.
To me at all?
As the patient had been reported as not breathing, a second crew have been sent to help.
It's OK.
Talk to me, sweetheart.
Yeah, you've got to think about bananas.
I actually don't think there's nothing that Carl doesn't know about me.
Do you know what happened in ages? Brought a banana.
Me and Sophie are like husband and wife. It's crazy. So, for us, the conversation goes from snacks to what we did this weekend.
I have a banana for breakfast, so I don't have to talk to you.
You kind of do build that relationship with your crewmate, that they kind of sort of know you better than you know yourself sometimes.
You don't have to go through the torment of having a banana in the camp.
Ambulance services, a patient breathing?
Yes, it's me, love, yeah. I keep getting sharp pains in my chest, love.
Are you on your own or are you somebody with you?
No, I'm on my own, love. I'm on my own.
Right then, so we are going to a 75-year-old male with chest pains.
For them to be woken up in the night with a pain is definitely concerning. This is definitely a time-critical emergency.
Looks like he's also got a history of cardiac problems and a high blood pressure, so there's a significant chance on this that he could be having a heart attack. At the least, something going on which is life-threatening.
Worst-case scenario with chest pain is the patient could go into cardiac arrest.
Alan, I'm Kyle, this is Sophie. How can we help tonight?
I've got a bit of a problem, sharp pains in my chest.
OK, no worries. Let me just pop over here.
75-year-old retired gas engineer Alan has a history of heart problems. So when he was woken up in the middle of the night by a sharp pain in his chest, he called for help.
How long's that been going on for?
He woke me up at 1 this morning.
So you occasionally have pains in the chest. Tonight it felt different.
Yeah, oh, totally. There it is again then, yeah.
You're looking at me, your eyes are moving. Did we have a fall?
You'll be able to get
okay. Have we banged ahead at all? No.
On the outskirts of Birmingham, student paramedic Carly and paramedic Brad are with a patient who is unresponsive after collapsing in the street. Her family are with her.
She was lowered down. Perfect. Come on, let's see if we can get you up, sweetheart.
So once I'd done my initial checks, I recognised that this patient wasn't in cardiac arrest.
Are you able to stand up? Perfect. Come on, lift yourself up, sweet.
You take a little breath and you realise that this patient isn't as poorly as what you initially thought.
Lovely, well done. Let's get you on the truck, sweet. Let's get you out of the way so we can get some privacy.
Perfect. There you go, sweet. Have a sit down. Let's get you covered up. Let's get you warmed up, shall we? Do you want your dad in here with you?
No.
Tell me what happened this evening, as just before we obviously turned up. What happened?
Been to different.
Yeah.
Today, we've been to the way.
Yeah.
We just went back to work on the house.
Yeah.
She was just leaving. Next thing you know, he says she's on the floor. So.
36.4 BM of 5.3.
Yeah.
So heart rate's up a bit, but whatever.
Oh, no, don't be angry.
Don't, it's honestly fine.
She had been to a relative's funeral today, so I think it's also important to not be judgmental. And in this case, alcohol was obviously a coping mechanism for her.
It's okay.
Can you tell me how you're feeling at the moment? You had alcohol today? Yeah. Anything else? No. I think what's happened here is we've gone past our drink limit, haven't we? And the knock-on effect to that is that your heart rate is going quite quick. Okay. And for the time period we were out there, initially I couldn't get a response out of you. Can you tell me where you are at the moment? Who am I? The ambulance. Perfect. Do you know what year we're in? 1991. My concern is that you've had a bit too much to drink, that you're now in a position where you're a bit of a danger to yourself in the way of you're not going to be able to appropriately look after yourself. I need to make sure that you're safe to go wherever you're going to go from here.
Brad explains to the patient's dad that at the moment, his daughter doesn't appear to have the mental capacity to take care of herself.
So it's one of these situations where she's not 100% with it still. So my preference would be to go to hospital with her, because she needs a period of observation. We're in a situation where it is and it isn't. If I think she's not got capacity, then it's my choice, unfortunately.
If a patient doesn't have capacity, then we obviously have to act in their best interests and take them to hospital to ensure that they are safe.
Tell me again, what year are we in? Perfect, 2022. Right.
Are you partner? So if you could just jump on, because at the moment we're in a bit of sort of grey area whether she has capacity to make a decision for herself because of how intoxicated she is.
Yeah.
Oh, goodness me, are you all right? You know what, another one injured. Are you OK?
The patient's boyfriend was also at the wake and fills in the missing gaps.
You just lay up a fence and woke up with ambulance. I'm not sure you didn't hit it, don't worry. I think you just drank too much. It's a stress though.
We're fairly confident that obviously everything that's happened this evening is due to alcohol. I need to be confident that we have got enough capacity to be able to say, I understand my heart rate's quick, okay? I want to get you looked at hospital, okay? And what do you want to do?
Keen not to go to hospital, Brad asks the patient questions again to see if she can recall what he's telling her. He needs to know if she's well enough to be left at home.
Did I say your heart rate was fast or slow? How fast did I say?
24.
Fine. So, one last thing. All right, I'm going to take these straps off you, and then we're just going to go, we're going to open these back doors, and we're going to go for a little bit of a walk. We're not going to climb a mountain, don't get me wrong. I need to make sure that you're safe, and that 2 minutes from now, 5 minutes from now, 10 minutes from now, I'm not going to get another phone call because you've hit the deck again. Stand up for me. We're going to do your blood pressure when you're standing. Now we're up and about, all right? Your heart rate's going too quick. I want you to get looked at for hospital for that. Well, I recommended that the patient came to hospital with us because of the fact she had a bit of a fast heart rate, which, again, most likely down to alcohol. But also to get that period of observation to make sure there's nothing sinister that we can't test for. OK, what do you want to do? What did I say before?
Alcohol.
Yeah, I'm fairly confident, yeah. But I just need you to understand the risks of our way to go to hospital. You don't want to go to hospital.
Yeah.
You all right? So this is where you were.
This young lady's boyfriend was obviously very caring. He came to pick her up following this incident, and he was happy to sort of take her home and look after her to ensure that she was safe.
Do you know where you're at now?
So, yeah, she's very lucky to have a partner like him that was taking care of her.
Carly and Brad would prefer to take the patient to hospital, but now she's proved awareness of her surroundings and condition, they can allow her to be accompanied home.
I get it, she's had a bad day today. She was soon in the position where she could tell me what was going on. And at the end of the day, if someone's got capacity and doesn't want to go to hospital, I can't force them.
No. She's
with
her boyfriend and family.
Yeah, he'll keep an eye on her all night. And if it changes, he'll phone us back.
Seven miles outside of Birmingham.
Right, nice and still for us for 1 minute. We'll run your blood pressure. Keep that arm nice and relaxed.
Paramedic Kyle and technician Sophie are with 75-year-old Alan, who's experiencing stabbing chest pains.
Alan says he's never had this pain before and he's never been awoken by this pain before, so we're quite concerned.
We'll stick some sticky dots on your chest and check your heart as well. Have you got any heart problems that you know of?
I've got
an ulcer on the aorta.
OK. So BP currently 199 systolic over 103. So when we did Alan's blood pressure, it was 199 over 103. Alan does have known high blood pressure, but this is still concerning for us. So other than the chest pain, is there anything else going on at the moment that you're concerned about?
No.
So you have no problems with your breathing?
Not at the moment, no.
Perfect.
Quick question is, how old are you?
75.
I was going to say 65, you say. I think you look absolutely cracking.
Yeah, she's charming, dear.
Only really, being honest.
Really important when we do this. So what I need you to do, pop your hands just on your lap for me, nice and relaxed. I know you're wired for sound. There we go. Nice and relaxed, nice and still. No talking or moving for 60 seconds, and we'll see what's happening.
Kyle performs a 12-lead electrocardiogram to monitor the condition of Alan's heart.
So we'll have a look at this ECG and see what's going on.
Yeah.
So, this pain, is it there right at this moment?
It keeps coming.
OK. So what I'm going to ask you to do, if that's okay, is take a deep breath in for me and let me know if that changes the pain.
There's no pain now.
OK. Any pain when I press there?
No.
None at all?
None at all.
Muscular chest pain can often mimic that of cardiac chest pain. That being said, it's really important we don't presume that something is muscular in nature. Ultimately, if we did so and they were having a cardiac event, it could well be catastrophic. The ECG we've done, it doesn't show anything we need to be immediately concerned about, but it doesn't show everything when it comes to a cardiac problem. So, we'll try giving you some aspirin and GTN, first of all.
If Alan is having a heart attack, aspirin can help prevent the formation of blood clots, and GTN will widen his blood vessels.
Oh, I've got a bit of tea left.
It can't beat a nice cup of tea, always say. Fixes everything, doesn't it?
Tea fixes everything, absolutely.
Right, so I've got you four of the aspirin there. So they're chewable, so just pop them in your mouth, chew them, and they will get, hopefully take some sort of effect.
Plan of action then, I'm going to call our cardiac nurse. So there's a team at Heartlands.
Yes,
is it there now?
That was sharp.
Okay. So what I'll do is give them a quick call and see whether it's something that they need to see you for pretty quickly tonight and what the best plan is to get you sorted. Hi there, I've got a 75-year-old male, Alan. He was woken up with sharp chest pain, described as stabbing in nature, approximately 3 hours ago. He reports some cardiac histories, had episodes of chest pain before, nothing like this, very out of character for him. It's hard to rule out what the cause of chest pain is. Ultimately, when it comes to a cardiac cause, something going on with your heart,
We need to take them to hospital so we can have a blood test.
All right, excellent. No worries. Yeah, thanks so much. We'll pop in. All right, thanks, guys. See you later. Bye-bye.
Right, bit of an update. So I've had a chat with the cardiac nurse at Heartlands Hospital. You've won yourself a trip to hospital tonight. So I'll take these off your ankles. Yeah.
Did you want me to go and get your charger for your phone and your iPad, and then did you want me to go in your bathroom to get your toothbrush?
Would be nice.
Yeah? Brilliant. I will go and do that for you. Do you want me to get you them socks that are on there for you to pop on? Yeah? And then what shoes are you thinking of wearing?
Honestly, Alan, next time you're going on holiday, just invite Sophie around. She'll pack your suitcase a lot.
And it's about packing. So you're packing all the things, so the essentials are on the top, so as soon as they need them, open the bag, there it is.
You're too organised, you are.
But that's why I pack the drain bags.
I know you do. Add back to your CV. Pro hospital backpacker.
Maybe I will. I can carry that for you, no problem at all.
Let's get you sorted. Do you want a blanket to keep you warm?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Let's get those doors shut. Keep it warm. And I've got the heating on max for you, so we're warming up.
Right then, I'm just going to stick these dots back on.
I fall asleep though.
Oh, excellent. Same here. Be two of us snoring on the way in.
Just going to do another tracing of your heart, Alan. So sit nice and still for us. Don't talk, but breathe as normal, OK?
So nothing's changed on there, which is good. We've just got to hope Sophie's driving is a nice, steady drive all the way. She normally hits all the potholes on purpose.
Well, I suppose we're going to be daughters today as well. See the grandkids, yeah.
How many grandkids have you got?
Altogether 11.
11 grandchildren? Expensive well, Christmas.
Yeah.
Take these off your wrist. So I'll pull these wires, I've already disconnected them. Yeah. Ready, three, yeah. Two, one.
Kyle and Sophie arrive at Birmingham City Hospital. Here, cardiologists will run blood tests to try and get to the bottom of what's causing Alan's stabbing chest pains.
First night in a while, so.
There's a lot of outstanding calls already.
If you were an animal, Ryan, I think you'd be a hyena.
I fully agree. Like, I feel like my laugh is unique. Let's go for... Let's go fox.
Fox?
I think at night time you're awake more. Not awake more.
But like, nocturnal.
Yeah.
That one.
Yeah, that's it. That's the scientific word I'm looking for.
How do you prepare for a night shift?
I go to bed whenever I feel like it. As much of a lion as I can.
Yeah.
Ambulance services to patient breathing.
My friend needs ambulance. I don't know what I can do.
Is the patient breathing?
No.
You need to stay on the line with me. We have emergency help arranged. I'm going to give you further instruction of how to give basic life support.
What are we going to?
Cat 1, cardiac arrest.
A category 1 call is the highest call we have.
Patient unconscious, very difficult to answer the phone.
Whenever you get that through, you're automatically thinking, oh, OK, this is quite serious.
Being told CPR in progress, old male, patient having breathing difficulties.
Received, many thanks.
Gets your adrenaline running. You're thinking about things like twice as fast.
Control, say that the patient is receiving CPR as we speak. By the bystanders. Hopefully we give them a good chance.
Essentially, they are dead and we need to get there quick so we can try and restart their heart.
Just here.
I'll get that one.
Thanking you.
As it's a cardiac arrest, a second crew have also been sent.
Hello. If you're nice. open your eyes. Open your eyes. Open your eyes for me.
Across the West Midlands, we're following eight paramedic crews simultaneously to capture a typical 12-hour night shift.
Thinking you.
In Coventry, paramedic Merrin and technician Ryan have been called to a cardiac arrest.
Open your eyes. Open your eyes.
It's the most serious of all 999 calls. As a result, two crews and an operations manager have been sent.
Now, I know you can hear me. Open your eyes for me. Open your eyes. Open your eyes for me. Hello, you're all right. It's not an arrest.
It's not.
No. I was happy that it wasn't a cardiac arrest. It was a relief just because I know that he can hear me. He's able to control his body, he's able to obey commands. He's responding to a point. Open your eyes for me. He's nodding his head. When you get to a job and it's not what it turns out to be, it's really frustrating and you get annoyed, but you can't show that you're
annoyed. We have emotions too.
Exactly. Has he taken any drugs at all? Alcohol? What did he drink today?
Vodka.
Vodka. Okay, no worries. If he, he's got pain, pain here, can you sit up for me? So, can you ask him to sit up?
I feel like the fact that there was a very strong language barrier just caused a lot of chaos,
yeah.
And that thrown in was a lot of confusion as well.
Definitely, because like, you want to get information, but it's hard to exchange information.
Can you ask him why not, please?
Fantastic. So the patient was pointing towards his mouth, so I was finally thinking that maybe he's got some sort of either like a toothache or he's got something wrong in his mouth.
Can
I look inside your mouth? What language does he speak?
Kurdish.
You need to talk to us, my lovely, in order for us to help you.
I feel like the patient wasn't cooperative at all. I can't really help you without you
telling
me what's wrong.
It's not helping himself, is it?
Exactly. Why can't you talk?
Because I love pain. Looking at my face, more
bigger. It's swollen in the face as well?
Yeah.
How long for?
Last night, just pain. But tonight, different. A lot of pain.
A lot of teeth are missing, a lot of like teeth were rotten or broken. I can see some swelling. He looks like he's got a dental abscess. Has he booked himself with a GP? A dentist, sorry.
Yeah, before, I think.
As this was reported to be a cardiac arrest, a second crew and an operations manager were dispatched.
No, thank you.
As it's clear this is a dental problem, the other crews are stood down.
And how long has it been in pain for like this today?
Tonight, 12 o'clock starting until now.
Has he had any paracetamol today?
Any paracetamol?
Yeah. My upbringing was like I wouldn't go to hospital or call an ambulance before I tried to sort the problem myself. So I would take pain relief, I'll take paracetamol, ibuprofen. Over-the-counter coconamol before...
Not just the one dose either.
No, exactly. You've got to make sure you take it regularly. Yeah.
Despite being in agony for over 3 hours, the patient hasn't taken any pain relief.
Oh, let's put your hand out for me. Put your hand out for me to take these medications. There's not much or anything but the hospital would do for him. He needs to go to dentist.
Yeah, I know he needs dentist, but now is everyone closed. So maybe tomorrow try to, when you open the dentist, try to take out.
So you can get an emergency dentist. If you ring
111.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can get an out of hour emergency dentist.
Like Ryan said, there's nothing we can do.
Okay.
And I don't think there's a lot of hospitals going to do. He needs to see a dentist.
Well, pain will only go once the problem's sorted. Once you have the teeth removed and the infection cleared away, that's when the pain will stop. If it's been going on for days, you should have booked the appointment with the dentist ages ago.
I don't think this job was appropriate for emergency ambulance. Like, there's literally nothing we can do.
I agree. You need to try your own painkillers first, see you get on. But at the end of the day, even with that, you need to speak with a dentist. Yeah. We can't refer you to a dentist, exactly. You know.
Medically, he's fine. It's just his dental problem. All right. But the longer he leaves it, the worse we'll get.
Merrin and Ryan can now move on to their next call after spending over 90 minutes with this patient.
Bye. No worries.
Take care.
Thank you. Bye. Bye now.
That job was quite annoying.
Yeah, it was, wasn't it? Listen, all those resources, two ambulances and an officer for something that doesn't need that.
He's definitely breathing. He's able to communicate. Toothache. Not a cardiac arrest, thankfully.
It was the fact that got me needed. It was 4 days and he's not took any pain relief whatsoever. He's phoned us, an ambulance service. It's frustrating.
Yeah, definitely.
Nice Chinese last night.
It was very nice actually.
I think the fact that I've stuck at being a paramedic for 26 years now would say that that's probably what I was meant to be doing.
It's really bizarre. I got home, as I pulled up into the drive, Simon was just going out the house. I said, where are you going? He said, to go and pick the Chinese
up. What did you have?
Chinese.
Every day's different. No 2 days are ever the same. You don't know what you're going to go to. Majority of the time, the patients are really nice. I do like it, definitely.
So that was a nice surprise. I wasn't expecting anything.
Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
Yeah, he's breathing. He was having some kind of seizure.
Is he fitting now?
Yeah.
Now I need you to move any objects out of the way to protect his head.
I'm sitting now, I had a temperature early 38.9. The patient has never had it before, and now I've had them twice a day.
When the job comes through and it says a child is fitting, all sorts of scenarios are going through your head.
Our main concern is that if they're still fitting by the time we get there, then they're in serious trouble.
Hello!
Hello.
Hello. Yes,
sorry.
What's his name?
Tommy.
Tommy, are you mum, are you?
Yeah, I'm Rachel.
Rachel, hi Rachel. I'm Mandy, this is Michelle.
We rang 909 and they got an out of hours GP to call us back.
Yeah, right.
At which point it had stopped and they said just keep an eye on him.
During the night, 2-year-old Tommy screamed out to mum, Rachel. She found him having a fit and immediately called an ambulance.
His temperature was measuring, we've got one of those ear ones,
measuring
37.4, like it wasn't. But he was sent home
from nursery today at 38.9. Right, with the temperature, OK. Yeah. Has he had a fit before, febrile convulsion?
No, never, and then it's happened again just now, we've called again and they've just sent
him home. A febrile convulsion is a child fitting due to their overheating, and it's their body's way of trying to cool them down.
Shall I pop this on your toe, shall we? Or your finger? I don't know which one you want. Or your toe, maybe toe, maybe.
If it is a febrile convulsion, they can be terrifying for parents, but children usually recover well.
Doctor. Yeah, you're
going to
be seen by a doctor.
Are you going to see the doctor?
My
doctor. You got a doctor?
I've got a doctor's kit, it's
a toolbox. Oh, have you? You've got a doctor's kit, have you? That's very good. See our little red light? It doesn't hurt. Just going to put it on your toe, like a plaster. Does it make your toe go all red, Tommy? It's not hurting, Tommy, it's not hurting.
I know.
Trying to treat a child who's resisting to you doing your examination is difficult. I know, sorry. I'll let go in a minute. I just need to stick it down, Tommy. Sorry. Let's have a look at your doctor's kit, Tommy.
150, 95.
No, it's gone. It's gone. It's all gone. It's all that. What's all that fuss about?
All done.
Oh.
All gone. Can I listen to your chest? Is that all right?
Don't mind, you've got to let the doctors help.
Can I have a listen? Helps if mom or dad, whoever's got them, is understanding, because of course they don't want to see their child upset, so you have to explain to the mom and dad as well what you're doing and the importance of doing it, so they can help you. You're going to do it.
You can listen to mummy's. No. Listen to mummy. Maybe. Hey, Tommy.
Oh, let me have a listen to your back, sweetie, as well. Having children ourselves, just, I suppose it does make it a little bit more, you can be a little bit more empathetic, maybe, because we've been through it ourselves.
It's that life experience again,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, God! No, it's not all done. You need
nearly
to
let done. That's a nice big breath in.
Well done.
That sounds okay. That sounds okay. I mean, it could be fit. It's difficult to say, but I think you probably just need to take him down to the hospital just right. to be checked, really, because we're not sure.
Is this your puppy, Tommy?
She's not a puppy. Well, she's old.
Is she an old dog?
What sort of dog is she?
She's a Bichon.
Is she Bichon Frise?
She's beautiful.
Yeah, she's beautiful. Right, she's very interested.
Darling, it's all right.
She's trying to get out.
We test people's blood sugars by taking a drop of blood, either from a finger or a heel, depending on their ages. We have to do that on children because their blood sugars can drop quite quickly.
Oh, no!
I know.
Nearly done.
I know. You're such a good boy. Good lad.
All done.
Should we put your sock back on?
All done.
It's all finished.
Right, Tommy.
Should we go for a ride in the ambulance, Tommy? Mummy's going to sit on here. But we need to pop your seatbelt on, sweetheart.
Mandy switches on the blue trauma lights to try and calm Tommy down.
We're moving now.
Oh, God, yes.
You can't get down yet.
Nearly. Well, Mum is coming too. Oh, we're moving, Tommy. It's a bit bouncy.
Bouncy.
Are you tired, Tommy? Yeah, I bet you're very tired, aren't you?
I will.
You do the song.
About to drop off.
2 seconds.
I think when I opened the back doors when we got to hospital and seeing Mom just totally relaxed, baby was relaxed, and Mandy was relaxed. It's always a good job done, isn't it?
There we go. I think Mummy's going to get a mask. Stand up for Mummy. No, not standing up, says. Right, well, that's it. We got everything.
Tommy and his mum arrive at Warwick Hospital, where paediatricians will run tests to try and find out what caused him to have a fit tonight. Mm-hmm. 15 miles away in Solihull, Kyle and Sophie are midway through their 12-hour shift.
You'd only listen to one song for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
What song would you listen to?
Craig David, 7 days. I think it's like, I don't know, sometimes you can just enjoy any day of the week.
Wow. No pun intended there.
Ambulance services, the patient breathing?
Yeah. My daughter, she's 2-year-old and she's standing on a chair and just falls. She falls on tiles
on her head. So has she lost any blood from anywhere?
No, she's drowsing though.
She's finding it hard to stay awake.
Yeah.
So we have got a female, 23 months old.
When any paramedic gets a call for a child, it definitely is that little bit more concerning.
Was standing on a chair and fell off and has bumped their head. To have a bruise on their head, patient is unable to stay awake and she is very drowsy.
With children and head injuries, it can lead to things such as bleeds on the brain, potential loss of consciousness.
told you I walk fast.
Well, no, my little legs can't keep up.
In Solihull, Kyle and Sophie have arrived at the home of a two-year-old who's fallen headfirst onto a tiled floor.
Hello. It's a strange saying in the ambulance service, but we quite like to hear a crying child. That's not because we want them to be upset, that's because we know they're breathing and we know that they're alive.
So I'm Sophie, this is Kyle. So what's going on today then? What's happened?
Well, we're in the kitchen. We're just sitting opposite and she's just playing on a chair and she just fell down and got her head.
Okay.
Yeah,
she's 4, 9, 9, 9, 9.
All right, then. So don't let her sleep, so she was still asleep.
Is it normally a bedtime? We're keeping her up?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I bet it hurt if she had a little tumble.
Yeah, definitely. It's turned down, but still we can see the sun.
Yeah.
There's definitely some bruising and swelling which is coming up.
Yeah, definitely.
So, what time did all of this happen then?
Around half five.
Alright then.
Have you given her any pain relief at all?
Not yet.
I think the one question we always want to know is, have they had the magic stuff that's liquid paracetamol?
I mean, it is always good. I actually do think it's magic.
Shall we start trying and get a feeling a little bit more relaxed, a bit better, and then we'll go from there and figure out a plan. Okay. Thanks, Al.
Right.
It might be magic, but not everyone is keen on it.
She had onions.
Oh, good girl.
Is that a brother?
Yeah.
Along with distracting his younger sister, Kuzi, Big Brother Sean is keen to watch Kyle and Sophie in action.
Has he been looking after her?
Yeah.
Big Brother's there on the case.
Amazing. Hello.
What was really nice to see is like the older brother being all caring for his sister. And he was interested in what we were doing as well, which is not, you know, usually doesn't happen.
Future paramedic for sure. Shall we show you our machine? Our
big iPad. Do you want to have a look at this?
Oh, wow.
Look at this. So, shall we press this button? And then look at the lights. So what we'll do, shall we put Brother Popsy's finger in here like this?
Oh, wow.
And then you pop your finger in here too, like you're matching.
Ready.
Wow, look, yours lights up. Wow.
Is it 100?
We're at 98.
Wow. That's it. Genuinely, you have some sort of secret talent when it comes to children. They all love you.
I don't know what power that is because I'm literally... I think it might be because I'm the size of a child, maybe. I've got a special torch. Wow. Can I have a look at your head? Wow, look. Can I just have a look at your head? Wow, okay, you're so brave. Are you sleepy? She had a little egg on her head, which in medical terms is known as a hematoma. This is when sort of an impact hits the area and it causes pooling of the blood, which then leads into sort of like an egg sort of shaped lump.
Ready for bed?
Do you want to have a go? So what we do, look, press this little button here. Ready? This one here. Press it down. Wow, look. You press it down. See? You know what you're doing.
I think she's going to be a paramedic.
Wow.
She knows how to use all our kit already.
I think we've definitely got a paramedic in the making here. I know, it makes some funny noises, doesn't it?
Fire! You're very good.
So the good news is there's no wounds on her head, so there's no concerns about it sort of needing any wound closure, there's no blood loss, anything like that. She definitely seems a normal self, which is positive. And there's been no vomiting, no loss of consciousness, none of those red flags that sometimes we look for in a head injury.
There you go, look.
Done.
Oh, are we done? What we'll do, we can write you a discharge form from ourselves, and we'll also give you a head injury form. So that's just sort of red flags to look out for. So sort of any vomiting, anything like that, which changes. You can either give us a call back or pop her up to A&E, all right. But she seems back to a normal little self, which is good.
Right then, buddy.
Nice to meet you, bye-bye.
23-month-old Koozie had a sore head for another week, but she's completely back to her normal self. Big brother Sean still dreams of becoming a paramedic one day. 2-year-old Tommy, who had a fit, was seen by doctors who discovered the seizure was brought on by viral gastroenteritis. After a night in hospital, he went home and has now made a full recovery. And Alan's stabbing chest pains were the result of muscle spasms brought on by a recent chest infection. He's now much better and enjoying spending time with his 11 grandchildren. Next time, a fall down a flight of stairs leaves a man with a head injury.
Have you got any pain in your back?
Is there any spinal concerns that could lead to being paralysed?
A husband and his wife need urgent medical help.
Started on your back.
Any chest pain potentially could be a heart attack.
And an intoxicated man is fitting by the side of the road.
Let's get you in the ambulance and you can talk to us.
He's an alcoholic, but we're there to help people, we're not there to judge.